through today is first of all to collect the intermediate results and then hint to two more, say, somewhat difficult aspects which are important for understanding the whole approach. First of all, remember that what we have said so far is that when talking about the concept of system, we are at the same time talking about networks in the first place. And the network is what we call the dynamical core of the system, because it's actually responsible for the dynamics in the sense that this is the network which describes the interactive communication among the members of the system, and the members of the system therefore are always agents. The objects of the system are always agents because they actually act on other agents, and therefore because the agents are practically the operators, operating on other agents and on the environment of these agents, a system or a theory of system is practically equivalent with a theory of games. Notice, of course, that these agents are not necessarily always human beings, so they are not fully developed agents, so to speak, in the sense that they have intentions, interests and all that. The agents can also be elementary particles or whatsoever, which is of course much more simple then, but the result is the same, that is, the agents are objects of the system that operate on other agents, and in other words, they interact or they communicate, and remember that we have said that communication is transport of information. Now, also we have seen that the concept of space is system is related to the concept of space, and this is so because the space is essentially describing the boundary of the system. Boundary is always indicated by a partial differential, that is this D. So D system means the boundary of a system, and the boundary of a system is in the first place defined as the mean-free path of the interactions. So in fact, where the interactions are not effective enough in order to operate, there is a boundary of the system. So it's a definition in terms of a domain of influence, actually. Where the domain of influence goes to zero, that is naturally the boundary of the system. So what we have is a world which consists of systems and of environments of systems. But of course, each environment of a system consists itself of systems and environments. So this is the reason why a system is in natural terms subjected to what we call self-reference. Because if you have a system which is defined by its boundary, then obviously everything outside is environment. But the environment consists also of other systems. So now obviously the idea is that the system is observing the environment and is reacting with respect to other systems nearby. So obviously this system observes this other system, but the reaction or the operation of this alien system is depending on the observations made with the original initial system. Yeah, because you see that is a consequence of the fact that first you have to observe and then you have to operate according to the consequences. Now, if you observe a system outside, then what you observe is already the result of what the other system has observed of yourself and is reacting accordingly. So, in observing this system outside, you are actually, at least partially, observe yourself. Yeah? And that is the reason why the system behavior is always adapted with respect to the observation that can be made, but the observation must be interpreted in a certain sense, and while doing so, the system is adapting to the other system. And therefore, each system is practically self-referent, because in interpreting other systems, it's also interpreting itself. We call that a self-image. Each system has practically a self-image of itself, but this is not autonomously developed. It's a consequence of what I observe with respect to other systems. If you translate this into the world of social systems consisting of persons, it means that the single person is adapting its own behavior according to what this person observes in terms of other persons. Because all these other persons are reacting to that special person, and therefore their reaction is already included in the observation made. So in fact, the person is behaving according to what the person thinks that the other persons would actually observe of herself, you see? That is a general philosophical result from French existentialism. It's actually invented by Jean-Paul Sartre. But as you can clearly recognize, without Sartre knowing about systems, that is also true in general for the theory of systems. Now, you see, the system itself is not the same as network and space, but it's a different perspective to look at. And the system itself is more than communication. Yeah, because communication is flow of information, as I said, but what you need is energy. So the system is all of that plus stuff. Yeah, stuff is practically the energy you need in order to do something. For instance, you can well communicate about building a house, but in the end you must have stuff, yeah? That means material, stones, otherwise you would not be able to build the house. But obviously that is energy, it's not information. Now the important point is, I think this is not functioning, or is it? It would be nice.
When it works, it's green.
Yeah, green is also very good. Green is hopeful. What you can do is to associate these three categories to three types of the mode of being of humans. Namely, space is related to cognition. Why is that so? Because from the beginning on, you are actually a member of a social space which you are perceiving, and you are reacting yourself according to what you learn about the structure of this social space. In other words, the cognition of human beings, and probably the cognition of all the agents, is already spatial, space-like. And that is actually the reason why we are able to express many things which are dynamical, but which we cannot express in a dynamical sense, we nevertheless can express in terms of very simple diagrams. And the diagrams themselves are completely meaningless because we simply use a kind of notation we have just invented, but nevertheless we can express the details by utilizing very simple lines and dots and circles and so on. And this, the true reason is that the graphical method, which is actually called graphism in ethnology, in anthropology, that the graphism, which means that people are able to express complicated things by very simple diagrams so that everyone is able to understand what is the general idea, this graphism is nothing but the material expression of our way of cognition, yeah? Because the cognition of human beings is already spatial. So what we do is actually, in the diagrams, we try to make a spatial design of some sort, which is very simple, but which serves the purpose. On the other hand, the network, the dynamical network, is obviously related to communication. So notice that cognition and communication cannot be dissolved. You see, you can only communicate if you have a well-working cognition and vice versa, otherwise it doesn't function. Because as a child, for instance, you can learn a lot of things, but only because the parents or other people are telling you what that actually is, otherwise you wouldn't be able to do so. And we will see in a minute, we will see another example for this. Different from communication and cognition, there is cooperation. Cooperation means that people find together in order to move stuff, yeah, which is something else than communicating. Because communicating, in a sense, is still abstract, but cooperating will become concrete. In other words, you are utilizing information if you deal with cognition and communication, but if you deal with cooperation, you are utilizing energy. And obviously, the one is not necessarily attached to the other, because you can communicate and cognize quite a lot, but this does not mean that you have to cooperate. That is something else which comes later. And therefore, there is a qualitative difference. So now, and as we have seen yesterday...
Yes. Here, some of the people were in the lectures of Wolfgang. So Wolfgang talked about the model, the triple C model, can you remember? So about communication, cognition, and cooperation. So there's a parallelism. So just to make the connection.
Actually, the Vienna people of Wolfgang are on the ontological side, so to speak, and they talk of communication, cognition, cooperation. And my own group, which came from the University of Kassel originally, they were on the epistemological side, talking about system, network, and space, but essentially that's equivalent. So now, we have seen yesterday that a very good graphical way to express all these interactions is by means of species, which means they are groups of individuals, yeah? And as we have seen yesterday, comparatively small groups. Now, petri nets, contrary to other types of interacting networks, have the advantage that they can be modeled in a stochastic sense. This means that what you do is you look up at the production of new species. The idea is that communication is always producing something new in the sense that the community which is communicating is changing by communicating. So the idea was that you have a large number of species, means a large number of groups, and then you can apply this matrix principle we have seen with respect to networks. Namely, you have here a row of n entries according to the species, so you get an n by n matrix, which may be very large. And the entries of this matrix is actually the transition from one species to the other, because the transition from one species to the other means that there is an interaction such that out of one species, a new species is actually produced in the sense that it is going over into other states. And this may be a species which is already available or not, it doesn't matter actually. But remember what we had in terms of social groups. If you have one social group which is interacting with another social group, then for both of these groups, the communication means that after communication you have practically two new groups, because the old groups are modified according to what you have communicated. So this is actually a production scheme, and what you do is you enter all these things, and remember that the main diagonal is zero, because that means that the group is interacting with itself. Yeah. But the rest, you can enter any numbers which are relevant. And of course, you choose the numbers according to qualifying the kind of interaction, obviously. And then you can divide all of this by n, which means that you talk about relative frequencies of transitions, or in other words, of the probability of a transition. So this is what we call the transition matrix. And the transition matrix describes essentially the set of all possible transitions according to the interaction processes which are available. So that is practically a picture of the dynamical result of all possible interactions you might have. And this matrix we call capital H. So the very important point with Petri-nets is now that you can actually define a very simple master equation which is telling you the development in time of these transition probabilities. Namely, if psi is a probability for a particular constellation of transitions, and H is a transition matrix in this sense, then the master equation is simply d psi by dt, so it's the first derivative according to time, and on the right-hand side you have this matrix H times psi. Yeah.
Psi
is a probability for a special constellation of transitions. So what you have here, that is a typical idea of a master equation, you have the development in time of a probability. Yeah. So that is very realistic, because many processes are subject to probabilities because you do not have the full information about them. Now, people who know a little physics recognize at once that this equation is actually Schrödinger's equation. Yeah. Schrödinger equation, that is the basic point of quantum mechanics. But there is a difference. The Schrödinger equation Thus almost looks so, but not quite, because the Schrödinger equation looks so. It has a small I on the left-hand side. And what is it? I is the imaginary unit that is the root of minus 1, because Schrödinger's equation is defined on complex numbers, not on real numbers. So what you have is two types of Schrödinger equations, namely one which is defined on the real numbers and one which is defined on the complex numbers. And in the first case, psi is a probability, but in the second case, psi is a probability amplitude. And this means that the probability itself is the square of the absolute value of psi. So, if you have complex spaces with probability amplitudes, you discuss quantum physics or quantum phenomena of all kinds. If you have real spaces and probabilities, you are discussing classical phenomena. So what you can conclude is that what Petri nets discuss in terms of all possible macroscopic processes which are stochastic is, in first approximation, nothing but the macroscopic version of quantum mechanics, or the other way around, quantum mechanics is a microscopic version of all what happens in everyday life, you see. And this will be very important for our conclusion tomorrow, because tomorrow we have the discussion of what we call decoherence, and that will lead us back to the idea of substance in the sense of Spinoza, from which we actually started in the first place. So this was point number one. Point number two deals with what we call topoi. All of that is, of course, in the lecture notes. Yeah, I'm just putting it together. So what are topoi? Now, of course, topoi is utilized in various ways, because the Greek word topos means not only location, but also special expressions which are standing expressions in literature, philosophy, or whatsoever. But in that case, topos means really location. Yeah? And topos is, however, a mathematical structure. Namely, topos is a category plus additional structure. What the category is, we had yesterday. Now what I would like to do is to explain this with an example I have already frequently used, which is somewhat funny. Namely, we are dealing with dogs again, not with rabbits and wolves, but now with dogs. Doggies, yeah, that means domestic dogs. We take the position of a little child, you know, who is actually learning that there are dogs, yeah, which is not so easy, in fact, for a child. Now, we have essentially, say, three types. We have one type of dog which is called German Shepherd. And B is, what have we done here? B is Great Dane. Yeah? Of course, I don't know what this Finnish name is, but I'd be able to reconstruct this. And C is actually in the original, in your lecture notes, it's Chihuahua, you know, that is the one you use in order to clean your bottles. But this, I do not take that for this case. I would rather take what is called a dachshund. Yeah? The reason is a special reason you will see immediately. So, you have three types of dogs. And what you also have is a name. That is D. And the name is obviously dog. Yeah? All of these are dogs. Now, the problem is, how can you formalize that in terms of mathematical mappings? Now, that is very easy, because you have the following criterion. You have two types of mappings, namely you have identifiers and you have similarity mappings. So, what you can say is, a German Shepherd can be identified as a dog. Yeah? So in other words, this mapping here means, is. The German Shepherd is a dog. That is one mapping, namely the identifying mapping of a German Shepherd. And also, the dachshund is a dog, means you identify the dachshund with that what you summarize under the name of dog. Imagine that the child knows that already. Yeah? But now comes the Great Dane. And this Great Dane is not necessarily classified. You see, that is not a trivial problem. I mean, of course, we know at once what is a dog and what is a cow or something like that, yeah? But of course, there are some dogs which are just at the boundary of a horse. And so, you know, the question is, what is that actually for a child? So, you have a second mapping that is a similarity mapping. Namely, you say, the Great Dane is similar to the German Shepherd, and the Great Dane is similar to the dachshund. Yeah? For instance, by certain given criteria, four legs and a tail and all that. Now, of course, that is only approximation. I mean, similar is not well defined. Yeah? But of course, intuitively, you can say, well, Great Dane is similar to these two. Now, the argument is the following. If the German Shepherd is a dog, and if the dachshund is a dog, and if the Great Dane is similar to the German Shepherd, and is also similar to the dachshund, then the Great Dane is also a dog. Yeah? So, if number one, yeah, Roman one, that is German Shepherd is dog, and Roman 2, that is dachshund, is a dog, and Roman 3, which means Great Dane is similar to German Shepherd, and Roman 4, Great Dane is similar to a dachshund, then Roman 5, Great Dane is a dog. Yeah? That's the concluding identification. And this is what in logic we call a modus ponens. Modus ponens means that you conclude from two given conditions. So if A and if B, then also C. That is modus ponens, and that is what the computer does all the day. it's Boolean algebra. So you see, little children are actually related to Boolean algebra, you see, without in fact knowing it. However, this is not what there is all to say, namely, you have a difference between the name and the concept. So what you have here is D star, and this is the concept of a dog. You see what the difference is. If you say this is the dog, or in German a Hund, or in French chien, that are different names, obviously, according to the language, but the concept is the same. So what you need is also a mapping which brings the modus ponens result to the concept. And because you start from here, and we call this an initial object, the Great Dane is the initial object, and the Great Dane, from the Great Dane you go upward to the name, and from the name to the concept. This is a bottom-up method. And this mapping here, in mathematics, is called the push-out. Yeah, don't ask me why, probably because it's going out of the diagram. So, unfortunately, the child is not quite successful yet, because it must also work the other way around. So, starting with the concept, you must be able to reverse all arrows and end up with something which you practically postulate according to what you know about the concept. So that is called the terminal object. The terminal object would be a kind of dog which you have not seen before, but which you can actually expect according to what you know about dogs in general. So that is a kind of implication. And it means that you simply reverse all that, so that instead of developing the concept bottom-up, what you do is to start with the concept go top-down. So when the child can claim to have understood what a dog is in general, once it is able to do both, to construct the concept bottom-up or top-down. And all of this is called a topos, namely it's a category. You see we have objects and morphisms. Objects are the dog types, the morphisms are the two types of mappings. Identificators and similarity mappings. And you must then have, that is a category, plus additional structure means you need a logic which is generally a Boolean logic according to the modus ponens. And you need push outs, and the reverse arrow is called pullbacks. And you need initial objects and terminal objects. And if you have that, then the category is a topos. So what you realize is that a topos in mathematics is something very elegant, because it is not only a mathematical structure which is describing certain processes or ideas, but at the same time it's providing you a special type of logic according to which you are actually describing things. And the important point is actually that either the logic is of Boolean type or of Heiting type. And the difference is in the negation. You see, There is one axiom in logic which is a negation, meaning that you have a proposition. If you have a proposition, then the negation of the negation of the proposition is again the proposition. Yeah. For instance, if you say as a proposition, this is number three, then the negation is this is not number three. In other words, it may be any other numbers. But if you once again take the negation, then the negation of the negation is it is not number three, and therefore it's obviously number three. That is Boolean logic. But nature is functioning in terms of Heiting logic, which means that this is not true anymore. The negation of the negation is not reproducing the original proposition. And why is that so? Because time comes in. You see, if you have a particular set, we call that S, yeah, then you might know that this is the complement of S. So this is S with a boundary, and then you have the environment, and the rest is called the complementary set. This is the complement of S. And the complement of S is all elements which are not members of the set, so they are actually the negation of the set. Yeah? So the complement is the same as a negation, in that case, for set theory. Now, obviously, if you have a Boolean logic, then this means that the set does not change, because in that case, the negation of the negation is again the old set, obviously. But now comes time in. In other words, S is changing. For instance, after a while, after time t, you have this S prime, which is obviously different from this. In other words, the complement of this has changed. It's not identical with that complement. And if you now take the negation of the original set, then what is coming out is something which is not equal to the original set because it has changed in the meantime. And that is what categories is all about, because as I said in the beginning, categories is simply a kind of changing sets, time-changing sets. And the natural logic is rather non-Boolean, but for our purposes, Boolean logic is practical if applied to computers, for instance.
Shouldn't we note differently the complement in the second place? So the outer complementary function also?
Yeah, no, it's not necessary, because a complement is always a complement. But important is the set on which you apply that. So the S is changing, but not the C. Mm-hmm. Because like here in the original case, the negation is always a negation, but the proposition is changing. Mm-hmm. So now, so far so good, yeah? Now we have seen that topoi are types of categories which are better associated with realistic daily life. However, this is not all what there is, because this child, having learned about dogs, for instance, and of course in the same manner it's learning about all possible other categories available, the point is that this cannot be handled by logic alone. That is what I said in the beginning, that we are always referred back to hermeneutic. And And hermeneutic practically is also a type of logic, but a logic which is subjected to very few information so that we are able to guess in a certain way. So instead of induction and deduction, we have something which is called abduction. Abduction This is an expression which, you know that induction is doing experiments and concluding the general rule. Deduction is that you have already certain basic equations from which you derive and assume certain phenomena, you try to actually find them. Abduction is that you have holes in your argument which you try to fill by means of guessing. And this expression has been introduced by Umberto Eco, actually, who, as you well know, is in fact a professor of semiology rather than only a writer. Umberto Eco argues in a way which is similar to Sherlock Holmes. You see, Sherlock Holmes is a detective who claims to argue in a strict logical sense. But if you read the stories, you realize that he never does that. Because what he does is that he utilizes the facts which he can observe. But there are plenty of possibilities in between where the development could be in one direction or in the other direction. So at certain critical points, he has actually to guess. But of course, the guessing is something you can actually train, because you see that it's depending on the probabilities of experiences. And this type of abduction is actually what is functioning all the while during everyday life where you don't have a scientific background. You see, most people know some fragments and they try to make an interpolation in order to have a sound explanation for something. That is what in psychology people call attribution. You see, attribution is if you are sitting in a cafe, you see, I mean, if you are a gentleman and you are sitting in a cafe like Jean-Paul Sartre and a very nice lady is passing by, then you think, oh, well, what might she be doing and is she married or not and something like that. Of course, you can't know that. I mean, except you ask her, but that would be very polite. Yeah? So, what are you doing? You are actually abducting a certain story. And sometimes it may be true and sometimes not, you see. But you need that in order to find an orientation in your daily world, you see. Because without that kind of attribution, you would not be able to have a kind of coherent action during the day. So this is what the child has actually to apply. And that is the reason why I utilize the dachshund instead of the chihuahua, because in England the dachshund is called sausage dog, you know, because he looks similar to that. Now, imagine that someone asked the child, would you like to have a hot dog? Now, a hot dog is obviously not quite what we think of a dog, but it's called hot dog. So, the child has difficulties, because if thinking of the dachshund, the child could argue, well, the dachshund, also otherwise called sausage dog, looks actually very much like a sausage, you know. So perhaps there are little dachshunds in that bun or bocadillo, yeah. But of course the Great Dane or German Shepherd does not actually like look like a sausage. So that is a point of irritation. So what the child has to understand is that there is a space of free play for the concept. Yeah? So you have a certain space around where you can modify the meaning of the concept such that you have to decide from the context what is actually meant. So if, for instance, the mother says, oh, Uncle John has a new girlfriend and he is an old hound, yeah? But of course the child thinks, well, he does not actually look similar to any of these. Yeah? But of course, dog is utilized here in a metaphorizing sense. So the metaphor is actually part of the space of replay. And therefore, this logic works well in a Boolean sense, or in a hiking sense, doesn't matter, but it must have this space of replay in order to also work in a hermeneutic sense, because that is how language actually functions. Yeah, so if a person says anything to you, then you have to think, well, he or she has said this and that, but what is he or she actually meaning? Yeah, because the meaning is usually different from what is being said. And of course, that has deep psychoanalytic reasons, because usually when we are talking, then we are meaning much more, because there is a kind of unconscious context underneath that, as a kind of subtext which is working under what we are actually saying. But you see that even in this logical application, this is somewhat problematic. And again, this is the reason why computation is limited, you see, because the pure Boolean approach, the modus ponens, that would be simply computation. Yeah? If A and if B, then C, that is quite easy. But the contextual idea of having a metaphor which is generalizing the concept, that is not included in the computation, and therefore you have to do more than that. Now, if you connect all of these aspects, then you realize what we do with it in the city. Because yesterday I said, well, you have many species or called groups, and the idea is now to find suitable patron nets, so to speak, in order to describe or to model the discourse. But there is a very important proposition. This proposition about topoi sounds a bit strange, but in fact it's very easy, and I quote from the lecture notes. I have actually met the inventor of this, with Stephen Vickers from here now at Milton Keynes, but at my time he was at Imperial College. I've studied at Imperial College a long time ago, but when I was a fellow in Cambridge, I very often came to London, and he is someone with whom it's very difficult to communicate, actually, because he only talks in terms of mathematics. Probably he cannot actually buy bread or milk or something like that, because he would give an equation instead. But he is very brilliant in his approaches, and so he has formulated the following, and this is actually the core of this approach to communication in city quarters. It is called a topos, that is a theorem. Actually, I can't remember from when it was, probably 2004. Theorem, the topos is a Lindenbaum-Tarski algebra for a logical theory whose models are the points of space. it's a very, I mean, I presume that you will not immediately uncover the deepness of this proposition, but in fact, it's a very brilliant result. And unfortunately, until now, I mean, that was 2004, and during the last 10 years, nobody has actually exploited it, I mean, except myself. Yeah? So I wonder about that. So the topos, the mathematical structure we have just seen, the category plus additional logical structure, is the same as a Lindenbaum-Tarski algebra for logical theory whose models are the points of space. So, of course, I have to explain all the parts. Now, first of all, the theory. What is a theory in general? Now, obviously, it's a set of propositions. So the theory is nothing but a set of propositions such that the propositions follow a certain order of arrangement. So you cannot utter arbitrary propositions. Of course, you cannot put them together in an arbitrary way. That depends on the rules of the field in which this theory is actually placed. Yeah, for instance, Newtonian mechanics is such a theory, and you have a number of axioms like the law of force and or the inertial motion axiom, and from this you derive a number of sentences which are propositions such that you can describe the motion of simple bodies moving according to, I don't know, gravitation or whatsoever. Yeah? Of course, for other fields, you have different kinds of theories. I mean, if you talk about sociology or psychology or biology, physics, and so on, that is, of course, all of that is different and is following different rules, but there are rules, and therefore you have a certain systematic approach in order to list all the sentences, it is propositions, that belong to the theory in question. Now, a model of a theory is simply a paradigmatic example. Yeah. For instance, a model of Newtonian mechanics is the theory of planetary motion. And a model of biology, for instance, of a biological theory in the sense of Darwin, for instance, would be the theory of DNA. Yeah. So models are parts of theories, namely such that they can be utilized as paradigmatic for that theory in order to illustrate what's all about. And therefore, models are subsets of propositions. Now for this, you can define an algebra. Now, the algebra is simply the arrangement of fundamental propositions, such as axioms and very important theorems and lemmata or corollaries which follow from the theorems and so on. So it's practically the important systematic core of this theory you are actually utilizing. Especially the Lindenbaum-Tarski algebra means simply that you are able to identify certain important logical elements. That should be enough for us. And in fact, we are talking here about special theories, namely about logical theories. In other words, we are not talking about hermeneutic here. Now, the important result of this proposition here is that such a theory with models acts as points of a space. That is, the models, which means the propositions, which are part of the subset, are themselves points of a space. Yeah? So if you have any abstract space, consisting of certain points, and then one point means a number of sentences, yeah, or propositions belonging to that theory. You see, that is what is behind the graphism. It means that you can express all these theories in graphical terms. But the important point is that you can simplify your method of research, because if you operate on these points here in that very simple space according to graphical rules, then what you do in fact is you manipulate the theory itself. So what you're doing is you do research. And that is actually what this book is all about, which I have published together with a colleague from computer science. That is the first computer playable game, which is called the glass bead game, according to the novel of Hermann Hesse, you see. So that is the first computer playable version of that game that was published, I think, in, I'm not quite sure, 1930 or something like that. And Hermann Hesse won the Nobel Prize for this novel, Nobel Prize in Literature at the time. But of course he never gave away how this game is actually played. Obviously he didn't know that himself. And this is a game of knowledge, yeah? In other words, it's a simulation of the research process. And unfortunately that is published in German with Springer, Creativity and Form. Program of a glass bead game for the experimenting with knowledge. Yeah? And the idea is that you have a cellular automaton-like system. And it's like the game of Go, the Asian game of Go, you know, you are putting your stones, you're playing stones on the intersection of the cells, and each stone represents a point in that abstract space, and each point is in fact a theoretical proposition. And in that case we have introduced propositions from physics, biology, computer science and philosophy. So what you can do is, you can either upload the inventory of propositions which are in the program, which are I think about 350 or so, and then you can try to work in your field and try to combine the propositions, or you can upload your own propositions, experimenting with your own ones. The result, I mean, so to say, the purpose of the game is to produce a new proposition which was not in the inventory before. Because if that is possible, then you have extended the theory and then you have performed research. So now what I would like to do is to prove the more general theory that the generalized version of this is actually relating to everyday theories. So that is these are non-scientific theories formulated in everyday life according to intuitive attribution. Yeah, that's what normal people do all the day. And that is obviously constituting the everyday discourse of these people. And I would like to show that this kind of generalized fuzzy type of theory has models which are points of social space. That is the idea. If that can be shown exactly, which is unfortunately not yet possible, but it's, say, a very strong conjecture, but it's not yet really proven. If that is possible, then you can argue that social space is modeled according to the ongoing discourse of the people which belong to this social space, Or vice versa, if you modify the discourse, you can modify the quality of the social space, and vice versa. And that is the idea as applied to living quarters in cities. Because the question is, if you change something in architectural terms, how can you, by doing so, change the behavior of the people living there? And obviously the behavior is changed in any way, but of course it should be changed in a positive way. And the idea goes back to a project of Richard Sennett, an American philosopher, who in 1990 was in the city of Jerusalem. And he had the task to develop a conception on the design of the Damascus Gate. Yeah, that is the old city gate of Jerusalem into the direction of Damascus. And he met a friend of his. They had studied together, and he was a Palestinian who was in charge of the water administration in Jerusalem at the time. And of course they were talking French, yeah, clearly. And the point was that the Palestinian friend complained about this project and said, well, I cannot actually understand how the modification of architectural surroundings can have any effect onto the militant behavior of our youth, meaning both Palestinians and Israelis. And in fact, Sennett could not answer at the time. Yeah? He could not really find an answer. But later on he said, well, he should have answered that Jerusalem is a very old city, and a similarly old city is Athens. And in the ancient Athens, it was in fact the architecture which was determining the behavior, because the life in Athens was a kind of tension between agora, which means the marketplace, and the theatron, which means not only theater, but also parliament. So in the agora, you could meet many different people from different countries offering their trade, you know, their products. You could be confronted with very many different languages and so on, or versions of Greek, say. You could discuss with these people in all flexible multi-variety and so on. So it was actually a place or a location of generalization and multitude. While on the other side, if you went into the theatron, the theater, once a year there was a theater festival, very large, and of course that was a task of concentration because you had to follow the intentions of the author. While utilizing the theater as parliament, of course you had to concentrate on the speeches and on the reactions among all the other people sitting there. Remember that the Greek people sat in the theater in the same way arranged according to their living quarters, like they sat in the parliament. And of course, that was not a true democracy. I mean, only the free adult German men, German Greek men were actually present. Yeah, so for Athens we speak about 5,000 to 6,000 people. But all of them could actually speak in the assembly. That was the full assembly, the ecclesia, and they could see how the others react and so on, so that was an active process of building up the opinion. But it was a very different mode of communication than on the marketplace. So in fact, daily life was actually arranged somehow between these two poles of public life in the tradition of Athens. Of course, that is only true for Greek polis, but not necessarily for the Persian capital or something like that. But at the time, this was a very important paradigm. So that was the starting point of Sennett. Unfortunately, he was 2 years ago, he was a guest at the London School of Economics, and I asked him whether he would have published anything else to that, but he hadn't, because these people change their interests all the time, so I think he has not worked anymore about that. But in the literature of Sennett, you can find quite many hints as to those developments. He is also discussing other examples from the medieval times, for instance, the development of the city of Venice, and so on and so on.
May I interrupt?
Yes.
So they are asking, so who is going to, who is going to join the dinner? So in the lunch, so we speak yesterday that maybe we could go some other way, some other place. So for today, there's only Cocino, so the only possibility, because there was a lot of people here, so the only possibility is that. I don't know whether somebody wants, or we go, you're not the same today. Mm-hmm. Then, or we go some place. So yes? So we go somewhere.
Possibly nearby, and not in Astorga.
Ah, yeah. Good. Do you understand? Do you have to use?
Mm-hmm. No.
Sorry.
Okay, so this is practically the underlying motivation of the whole project, you see. The idea is to actually study the topos for a given city. Yeah, that is very similar to what I showed you yesterday in terms of petri nets. Of course, petri nets is a detailed side of the work. And you see, if you think of this transition matrix, which is establishing what the physicists call the Hamiltonian of the modified classical Schrödinger equation. Wait a second. So if you think of the possibly gigantic dimensions of this matrix, then obviously you can only compute this in terms of computer programs. But this doesn't change the fact that the important points are the critical points of the evolution of this equation here. And so you can, of course, study partial properties of this matrix in order to get some insight into the ongoing discourses which determine the overall urban discourse in the given topos, so to speak. And of course, the nice thing is that topos, having the original meaning of location, is actually exactly to the point. So that what you're doing is actually a topology rather than a geometry. You see, you are doing more topology, and therefore I called that once when I gave my lecture courses at the Center of Metropolitan Studies at the University of Technology in Berlin. I called that topology of communication. Yeah? So you see directly the interdependence of the spatial context to what actually happens in practice. And of course, you have not to go to Jerusalem nowadays in order to find cities which are very much organized in critical terms. Yeah? I mean, where I think that practically each large city has similar problems nowadays, more or less depending on the political context, but in general, the question is always, how can you actually modify the living space in practical terms such that you achieve an improvement of the situation. Yeah? And of course, in order to do so, you have first of all to know what would be an improvement of the situation. So you actually have to ask the people, yeah, and you look for the discourse which is ongoing in order to get an intuition for what people would actually like to have. And that is also a question of socialization. Yeah, it actually depends on the detailed socialization, and therefore it's a question of the cultural context altogether. But of course, not culture in the sense of alien people or so, but culture in the sense that everyone comes from one particular culture, you see. I mean, even in the same country, you have different cultures in that sense, because the contexts are different. And once you have achieved this, then the question is, you cannot, of course you can partially, but not really, influence the ongoing discourse. That is a problem of the classical anthropologists like Malinowski or Levi-Strauss, who went to various places in order to study the people there. And of course, they, as external observers, they had always difficulties in order to understand what is actually going on. So what we have nowadays in terms of anthropological models is more the European perspective onto these models. And the people living there, they are simply living, you know, they do not do models. So that is always the difficulty. But what you can do in any case is you can, by means of city planning, you can change the environment. Yeah? You can change the architecture, the traffic flows, the economical functions, like economic functions, like shops or the institutions, schools, kindergartens, and so on and so on. And in fact, there is a Swiss town planner who is called Mr. Wösch. He has actually published a very small book in Switzerland on the general principles of town planning, and what he does is he describes minimal conditions on living quarters. And interestingly enough, these minimal conditions are very similar to what are the minimal conditions for systems, because he defines, for instance, a typical diameter, which means a typical boundary of such a living quarter. And of course, a boundary of a living quarter is not a wall or something like that, but it's, for instance, a kind of virtual gate, yeah, defined in terms of a park or garden, or for instance, an architect who was actually motivating my original work in Bologna, he was from Munich, and he was actually responsible for the city development in Bologna about 1980, of the name of Winkler, actually. And he has since then built very many things in Italy, actually. But especially in Bologna, he has invented the virtual gate idea. I noticed recently that probably my photos are not more available on my Vienna website, because when I was in Bologna, I photographed myself all the old ancient city gates, and recently I haven't found them, but they might be on the net. We know that nothing is forgotten in the net, so you will also find these. So the point is that there is practically nothing left from the ancient city wall, but the gates are left as ruins, of course, and some of them have completely vanished. So what you have is a collection of ruins of gates, and you have two empty spaces. And so what he has done is he has defined a pedestrian area inside that circle, which is actually surrounded by a bus going one way and the other, and essentially it's a bus who brings you to the central station. It's called Cioccolatore, and you see inside this area, the idea was to have a pedestrian zone which is identical with the ancient city center. And of course, in the meantime, the political parties changed and so, and the project was not actually realized completely, so that when you now come to Bologna, you do not have a pedestrian zone, but only partially at the Piazza Maggiore and so on. But that is, you know that Bologna is also a Roman foundation, Castel Bologna, and so it has a typical square system. And so far as this Roman nucleus is concerned, the idea was realized, but the rest unfortunately is not completely realized. But the point was that the idea of the gates was to have here a kind of boundary point, in the sense that you have the concentration of taxis, so that you can walk out of the center, take a taxi and go in to other areas of the city. And of course, the buses would pass this gate as a kind of intersection points. And the two empty spaces where you don't have any ruins anymore were designed such that they look as if there would be actually a gate. Yeah? Very nicely done, so that it's a virtual gate. And in fact, in Bologna you have also a pilgrim's pass, because that is very interesting. They have very many arcades, portici, in the city, which is a typical significant characteristic. But in that case, to the place where the pilgrims are supposed to migrate, they have the arcades up to the mountaintop. Yeah? So that is very curious, because you walk out of the city, but you are still walking in the arcades, you know, as if you would not have left the city in the first place. So this is very nicely done. Now, the point is that the idea was, by doing so, to actually influence the city life. As you might know, Bologna was, for a very long while, administered by the Italian Communist Party. So, in the 50s, 60s, 70s, people tried to apply what Marxists are used to call scientific methods, yeah, meaning methods according to Marxist principles. And the what meant that they had the city administration in the usual sense, but parallel to it, they had so-called citizen councils, which were constituted of the people living in a certain living quarter. So they were deciding about architectural things and economical things in their area. And then afterwards, the city administration would do the same once more. Of course, you can imagine that was far too expensive after all. So the city of Bologna had always very many debts, but they argued that actually the government in Rome would be responsible for that, because they were not sending enough money. So for a long time this worked very nicely, and they could offer bus services free of charge, and they had very many buses there, because you had otherwise pedestrian traffic rather than private cars, and so on. Unfortunately, this ceased because there was, as you might remember, what we call the historical compromise in Italy. What is it? Historical. Because the Communist Party made a coalition with the Democrazia Cristiana, and then, of course, they had to stop this system with making more debts. But the point is that in that case, you actually can trace the results of the urban planning into the detailed microstructure of the people living in these quarters, you know, by means of an interaction of the governing discourse and the planning which is actually performed afterwards. So this might be perhaps an essential idea, and Bösch is giving you the general criteria, for instance, that one should be able to reach all possible things you need during the day, from cradles, kindergartens, schools, parks, shops of all kinds, administrative institutions or so, by walking distance, and he is of course thinking of the usual rhythm, which means 4 kilometers per hour, yeah, so that you should reach during half an hour everything you need. And then the city is practically composed of very many such living quarters, which are collected into hyper quarters, so to speak, yeah, quarters of quarters. And by doing so, what you will get is a fractal structure. Yeah? The first fractal structure in a modern European city was the city of Bologna, which is actually founded in 1115. And fractality means that, in the first place, that it's self-similar. That is, the structure of the whole city is mirrored in each part, which means in each of the districts, and each district is mirrored in each living quarter. And obviously this fractal structure is a kind of, say, natural law for the living together of people in settlements. So it's, it has been proved to be quite universal. In fact, Gordana yesterday pointed to an author who is actually dealing with that. I wonder whether I find this. I have here the chapter 7.4, which is a section, which is page 121, Application Cities as Emerging Complex Systems. There I'm talking about the works of Bettencourt, who was mentioned yesterday in the talk of Gordana's. And later on, I come to this 7.5.133, further remarks on the fractality of cities, and that is dealing with the work of Michael Batty, who has published the book we have seen yesterday, Fractal Cities, from 1994. In fact, the English are quite well on to the point there, because they have practically 4 schools dealing with that by now. We could call that a mathematical theory of city architecture, so to speak. And this is the one I already mentioned at University College, Bill Hillier and people, then the Michael Batty and Bettencourt. There is an extra institute, you can find that in the internet. In London, who is dealing with these things. And there's Michael Layton at Coventry, who is also dealing with a mathematical theory of cognition, which is actually the basis for his theory of architecture. And architecture is not meant here in the sense of, you know, building cathedrals and all that. It's actually meant in the sense of city planning, you know. I mean, architecture means the design of urban space. Not only building houses, also, yeah, building everything what you actually need. Okay, so coming to a close for today, I would now just mention a couple of general things. I mean, it's not worthwhile. In the lecture notes, you will find that I have discussed various details of the works of Batty and Bettencourt and so on, but it's not useful to do that here in detail. But what I would like to do instead is to point to some difficulties, yeah? Because these works you can even find in the newspapers. I mean, they have actually entered the public domain. But unfortunately, of course, that is usually the case if journalists acquire a certain knowledge and publish that afterwards, is of course that the basic ideas are not quite clear. You never know what is actually metaphor or what is real. And therefore it's necessary to have a somewhat critical look at these things, which I will do now. That is perhaps similar to that work. I mean, I would not like to create misunderstandings. For instance, I estimate the work of Godard quite well, yeah, but always you have to be careful not to overwork your conception. And so what I yesterday called a very big optimism is sometimes a very big utilization of metaphors which are not actually recognizable as metaphors. So the first would be yes, I can perhaps repeat here once more. In fact, the first paper of myself is going back to a conference we had at a very nice place, namely at Cumberland Lodge, which is the flat of the Queen Mother in Windsor Castle, very, very nice. That was a conference that was published with a rival publisher, Dordrecht Posten, 1986. And I have written there the transition from town to city metropolitan behavior in the 19th century, because what I'm talking about is starting with the development of Paris and London as the first very big cities in the 19th century. All these problems we are dealing with are actually emerging at the beginning of the 19th century, or to be more precise, about 1830, when there was a very strong migration from the countryside into the big capitals. I quote from the lecture notes: the implications of urban structures visualized as essentially linguistic networks has been discussed elsewhere in more detail, starting from the concept of ancient polis. That is my city book I referred to, which is hopefully coming out these days. In other words, the initial comprehending of urban space is significantly based on the cognition and communication of the persons socialized within the framework of this space. The geometric properties of geographic space are only secondary to this process. What counts in the first place is the loading of places or locations with social connotations, rather than simply registering the morphology of the architecture or the structure of economic functions. In a sense, it is the other way around. While it is a discourse that constructs social space, the latter's geographic properties are simply indicators for discursive starting points. And then I come to the novel interest which is created in city research. Perhaps before I'm coming to Bettencourt, I should go back to the sentence I've just quoted, because what this kind of space actually is called the holological space. So that is going back to the school of Gestalt psychologists in Berlin in the 20s and 30s by a Mr. Levin, for instance, and by Köhler. They actually invented this expression, but it was heavily used in the philosophy of Jean-Paul Sartre. So if you read Being and Nothingness in Lettres et l'Union, that is the first main work of Sartre, 1943, then in fact, page 500, easy to recognize, so that is on the ontological space. And Sartre explains this in terms of the novel by Marcel Proust, La Rochelle, recherche du temps perdu and the research for lost time, because this name comes from Hodos, which means actually route or way. So it's actually the horological space is actually the space of routes you are taking in everyday life. Yeah. So if you have a living somewhere, a house where you live, then of course you have to go various routes in order to do your daily things according to your age, of course. I mean, very little children will roughly stay at the house, but then they go to school and so on and so on. And other points are friends or relatives they are visiting very often and so on. Now the important point in the horological space is that the geographical aspect is only secondary because, of course, everywhere you have these routes, but especially, of course, in the city, because a route in the city is practically going through a tunnel there, which is open at the top, but that it's like a labyrinth you are actually passing. So, in fact, in terms of cognition, that is very important for the children because without realizing it, they detect the morphology of the surroundings, and that is what intuitively, as growing ups, they would actually prefer as a living space. Yeah? So, if you come into a strange city, then you recognize immediately morphological structures which remind you of the times when you were small and had a special kind of morphology in terms of the buildings around, the trees in the streets, the traffic flow and so on. Now, the point is that the houses as such are not very important, but important is the social connotation you attach to these houses according to the interaction with the people you are visiting there. Yeah, for instance, if you are a small child and you have an aunt, you are obliged to visit all the time, but you don't actually like her, you know, then this will obviously represent a social connotation of that place. So if the aunt has died a long time ago, but the house is still standing, then you will always associate this location with the connotation you have developed with respect to the interaction with that aunt. Of course, also in all the other cases, whether that be family members, friends, or whatsoever. Yeah? So what you do actually, and that is the reason is that you're actually not moving in geographical space, but you're moving in social space. And social space is geographical space plus all social connotations, you see. So this space which is developed then, this is called the homological space. And there was a German philosopher before the last war called Walter Benjamin, and he has proposed to draw private maps of cities, you see, and a private map is practically the homological space of one person. So the whole city is not actually what you see on the city map, but that is a superposition of all homological spaces of all the inhabitants. Yeah? And of course, if you would like to know about the quality of living in the city, or in other words, to ask what the people who live there would actually like to have, then what you should do is to study the superposition of all the homological spaces, because in the result, that is actually what the people would like to have on the average. Yeah? And so you are practically in a zone of stability where, when you do your planning, you are on the safe side. So, coming back, the first I discuss here is Betancourt. And in fact, of course, the study of very large cities is very important by now. I refer here to the United Nations report of 2006 and 2007, which is concentrating on this so-called slum development, and the United Nations report of 2008 and 9 on the concept of harmonious cities. You can actually access all these texts in the internet and download as PDF files, which is very interesting to read. Bettencourt has started his work at the Santa Fe Institute in New Mexico, which is actually the home of what we call self-organized criticality, that is a generalized approach to chaos theory. And chaos theory is a kind of universal approach to processes altogether, among others, to the processes of producing city quarters. Now, consequently, Bettencourt's idea is to develop an approach which is dealing with what we call scale-invariant relations, and that is actually at the core of chaos theory. Perhaps you should note a difference here as to fractality, because that is very often mixed up. You see, chaos theory is actually dealing with phase spaces, contrary to self to self-organized criticality. So chaos theory goes back to many people, but among others to Ilya Prigozhin in Brussels, who has started in the end of the 70s with talking about self-organized processes. This is working in phase space in the following sense. The phase space is the space of possible states of a system. So if you notice all the states which are actually encountered during the history of a system, then the history of a system is a curve in phase space. That is a set of states which were possible before and have been actualized. That is very common in physics, but also in other fields. And what you do is essentially you classify the types of curves which are showing up, because by doing so you classify the history of systems. Now, you have essentially three types of them. Namely, you have closed curves, and you have a space where you cannot actually recognize a curve because everything is covered, and you have something which is in the middle, maybe it's a closed curve, but it's smeared out somehow over the space. Now you see the dimension of a curve in phase space is one dimensional, obviously, because any curve, any line, has dimension one. Now, if you're on the right end here, where the curve is covering all of space, it actually means that the curve, when covering the flat space here, namely the square, is actually two-dimensional, because that is the surface. So, this case is dimension one, and this case is dimension two. In the first case, you have a normal equilibrium process, which you know from school, you know, in closed thermodynamical systems where nothing happens very much. And therefore you have very nice closed curves. And the closed curve in phase space is an oscillatory motion. Yeah? You know that if you have a sine function or a cosine function, then you can project that onto the unit circle, yeah? And the unit circle going around always is actually what the sine function is doing all the time, oscillating back and forth, yeah? So a closed curve is an oscillatory process of classical type nothing happens in particular that is thermodynamically very ideal for closed systems, which are, however, very unrealistic. On the other side, where the curve is covering all of phase space, you have what we call stochastic chaos, meaning that you have complete disorder, there is no order at all. And you recognize this because the dimension of the phase space goes to 2 instead of 1, like in the first case. In the middle, you have a mixture of both. You have a determined nucleus, which is implied by the closed curve, but the closed curve is not very nice, it's a fuzzy curve, and this is due to the fact that by perturbing this curve a little, you get completely different results, and that is a property of chaos, and it's actually called not stochastic chaos, because it has an order as a nucleus, it's called deterministic chaos. Meaning that it has a deterministic nucleus, but the rest is stochastic. While in the other case of stochastic chaos, you have complete disorder. Here you have some order, but it's somewhat complicated. And in fact, 90% of the processes in nature are deterministic chaotic. So that is the rule, not the exception. Now you realize that this curve is oscillating between 1 and 2. Yeah? It's 1 point something, because it is between the line and the surface. And therefore the dimension is broken. And because the dimension is broken, 1 point instead of 1 and 2, it's called fractal. And therefore, a fractal geometry of phase space is indicating deterministic chaos. So either you find a chaotic process and you know the phase space is fractal, or you find a fractal space, then you know it's a picture of a chaotic process. So that is Prigogine, that is chaos theory. But the people in Santa Fe doing self-organized criticality, which means SOC, and this is essentially the same, but not for phase spaces, but for observable Euclidean spaces, for the normal space. I call that observable space in 3 dimensions. And an example is, for instance, very famous example is the coastline of England. Yeah? Because you have a typical form, you know that from the atlas, but if you magnify the coastline in order to look for a certain location or so, you realize that it's becoming longer all the time. But it is reproducing the overall structure in the detail. So the more you are magnifying, of course, the more information you get, but the structure remains the same. And you can do a similar thing, for instance, for the coastline of Norway, which has these fjord parts, and they are reproducing very well. That is, you are not in phase space, you are in a space you can well observe in everyday life, but you have nonetheless a fractal structure. Because if you measure the line of England, for instance, it's becoming longer and longer, and afterwards, practically, you see that the curvature is so intricate that you have practically a surface or something in between. I think the dimension of the coastline of England is something about 1.4, something between the line and the surface. So the important point is that the latter processes of self-organized criticality are distributed according to a free scale, to a scale-free system, which means that they are mostly written as functions with broken exponents. Yeah? The broken exponents in the function reflect the fractal dimension. The point is that very many processes in nature, like the formation of mountains or the formation of a coastline by the permanent action of waves, or the emergence of volcanic activity, and so on, all these can be covered in terms of self-organized criticality. So in fact, you need some other mathematical criteria in order to describe that properly, but for our purposes, if related to Evans space mechanisms, it suffices to remember that fractal dimension is related to self-similarity of structures, because that is the important aspect which is discussed in terms of city research. Now, finally, I want to mention the work of Betty. You see, Betty has a very nice idea, and I liked it very much. First, before I looked at it in more detail, because he actually is discussing the city like a star, that is shown on page 126. You see, he argues that the agglomeration of cities is working very much like the agglomeration of stars at the beginning of their activity. And what he introduces is, of course, as a metaphor, his properties which belong to stars. So, for instance, if a city is very active, it gets, in his case, a very high degree of luminosity. You know, luminosity is, of course, the sign for activity of a star. And so he applies that to the city. But obviously, you see, this metaphor is not very bad, because if you look at a satellite map by night, you obviously see that very big cities are very bright indeed during the night, you see, so that you can find a relation to the activity of the city and the brightness in terms of luminosity. But of course, that is as far as the metaphor goes, because otherwise, you should have a set of equations, which he is actually using in terms of differential equations, which are similar to the equations that govern the development of stars. And that is, of course, not true. Yeah? And I've shown, I've demonstrated this here around page 126. Essentially, in the classical models, in order to describe the development of stars, you have three equations. One equation for the mass, one equation for the pressure, and one equation for the luminosity. You see, a star is nothing but a kind of energy station, in the sense that a star burns all the time hydrogen. And by doing so, it is producing radiation, which is sent outward. Yeah, that is the main task of a star. The star has to shine. Yeah, that is the point. Because the light, then part of the light is coming to us, and that is very important, because otherwise we would not be here, actually. Now, in order to remain stable, the star has, of course, because he is producing a radiation pressure all the time, has to have a compensating component, and that is gravitation, obviously. So it's depending on the star's mass. So there is an equilibrium so long as, because the pressure equals the gravitation, so long you have enough hydrogen. Once that is not more the case, the star has to collapse in order to find a new equilibrium. And there are only three final stages, namely a white dwarf, which is a very small, not very bright star, with a quite high density of mass. That is the destiny of our Sun in 4.5 billion years. But for stars which are a little larger, the result will be a neutron star, which is a very small star containing neutrons only, but actually being not very bright, but of course having quite a lot of gravitation. You see the mass is conserved in physics, so gravitation is. But most of the stars, which are larger than roughly 2.5 times the mass of the Sun, they will become black holes, which means they have to collapse so far that the gravity on their surface is so high that not even light can escape, and therefore they are called black holes because nothing is coming out. And that is the usual case of a final state for a star in our universe. So, now, in very simple thermodynamic manner, in a classical model, for a period where the star is relatively stable, and we can say that our Sun is relatively stable, we have these equations here, which are not very complicated, and together with these three equations, you have two more equations for the temperature development. And that depends on, you have two versions of them, because you have two versions of processes that take place in thermodynamical terms in the star. Now, if you write down these expressions, then you realize at once that this cannot be a city model, because it may be a city model in the metaphorical sense, but we have, of course, not the same set of physical constants, you see, and that is changing, of course, the quality of the underlying processes. So if you would like to save the metaphor, which might be useful in one or the other case, then, of course, you have to approximate these equations, and you have to define what the other quantities, which are not mentioned by Betty, actually would mean for the city development. Yeah. Once you can achieve this, this would be a nice model. I mean, I would like that, you know, talking about cities like the development of stars, that is not too bad. You see, if you have a map of our galaxy, or not of our own galaxy, but of Andromeda, for instance, our neighboring galaxy, then these galaxies look rather like cities in the universe, you know, and otherwise everything is black and dark, but the galaxies are very bright, and so you could argue these are cities of stars, you know. Unfortunately, they have 100 billion inhabitants, but nevertheless, of course, there might be some useful application of this, but you have to be careful not to think now that obviously a city functions like a star. You know, that is obviously not true. And I have discussed that in more detail here in that chapter around page 126. Okay, for today, that should be enough.
Would you say Betty is Betancourt?
No, no, Betty is Betty, Betancourt is Betancourt.
Okay. Now, because I don't see the I don't
find I start with Betancourt, and then I come to Betty.
But I don't find it.